So our departments are just getting busier. If you get down to my department right now, I can tell you it's busy, it's full, and it's been like that way for weeks. Yeah. But every now and then, something like this happens, doesn't it? We all read about these cases in the paper. We probably know someone that was seriously injured in a road traffic accident, or an ATV accident, or a sporting accident. Imagine trying to coordinate all that activity. And then imagine you work here. As an emergency physician working here, how many major trauma patients do you think I will see a year? See, between 4 and 7 of those cases a year. Would you let a cardiac surgeon operate on you if he did it 4 or 7 times a year? No, you wouldn't, would you? Okay. Let's make the case a little smaller. Let's make him a child. Okay, this is a young man. He's been hit by a car. Probably the biggest mechanism for motor vehicle related incidents in kids. Unfortunately, they get hit by cars. And when they get hit by cars, the bumper hits them straight in the leg. Their head hits the windscreen. If they're lucky, they get away without chest injuries. And they come in with big leg injuries, with a big head injury, in a coma. Again, look at all the people around that case. Look at all the coordination that would take to make that work effectively. How many cases like that do you think I see a year? Pediatric major trauma. I'm sticking with trauma because we've got good data on trauma. 2 cases a year. Would you let me operate on you as a surgeon if I did it twice a year? No, you wouldn't, would you? Well, you'll see very quickly in a real emergency situation, there's a lot more to it than just the patient. There's managing yourself. What tactics are you taught as a clinician to control your fear? So when the 3-month-old comes in who's been dropped out of a window, how do you control yourself so you don't lose it? How do you communicate with your team in a clear, focused, and understandable fashion? That needs to be taught. What time did this pain start, sir? Okay.
Running in the gym, and it's been a couple of hours.
Okay. So just to fill the team in, we've got a chap, a middle-aged man. He's had chest pain for a couple of hours. He's clearly got an anteroceptal MI on his ECG. So let's alert the cath lab, prepare to transfer him to the cath lab, and try and get him revascularized.
And his blood pressure right now
blood pressure is 78. Okay, can we draw up 10 mils of 1 in 100,000 epinephrine. Okay. So get an epinephrine mini jet, take 1 mil out and dilute that into 10.
Are you getting that, Kim?
Airway's currently okay. He sounds like he's got pulmonary edema. He doesn't have a radial pulse. So let's get his pressure up and get him around to the cath lab.
Perfect. 19, 20, 21,
22, 3, 4. Stop CPR. VFib on the monitor, Dr.
Yeah, so let's back on the chest, please. Let's charge to 200 joules monophasic defibrillation.
4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 18, 19, 20. So we're fully charged? Stop CPR. Everybody clear? Shock delivered? Continue.
Back. B's and C's are happening. Right, 5 H's, 5 T's. Hypoxia we're taking care of, hypovolemia we're taking care of. Yes. Hyperkalemia, we'll get an ISTAT done. We don't know about anything. I mean, this is going to be thromboembolic, isn't it, I think.
Yeah. And the charge nurse has gone out to speak to his wife. And
okay.
Let
him know. Yes, we just stop for a second. Right, he appears to have an organized rhythm. Has he got a pulse?
Yes, he does have a pulse.
He's got no radius. He's got a central pulse?
He's got a central pulse.
Okay.